Good morning. I greet you in the name of Jesus, and I'm so very thankful to see you here this morning with us. As a reminder, if you would you please tear off the side portion of your bulletin and register your attendance with us this morning? And if you're watching at home on Facebook Live, if you'll just say hello or just let us know you're there. If you have any prayer requests, you can include those also. But we just like to keep a record of our friends and loved ones that are visiting with us each Sunday. Also, for announcements, if you are working with VBS, there's going to be a VBS crew leader meeting today at 4 p.m. here in the sanctuary. And even though I don't want to mention this at all, and I'm super excited to have this time with you next Sunday, but there will be a farewell breakfast for me and my family next Sunday, the 13th, from 10 to 11 in the Narthex. So I hope that you will come and I will be able to love on you and just say my goodbyes to each of you next Sunday. And maybe, I don't know, maybe I'll just get on this train and leave now and go on vacation since it's here. Oh! There's a train coming! So all aboard the VBS train. If you're not excited, you should be. Or maybe Jill and I are just excited. I don't know, but this is going to be great. And this will clear out in a minute. But it'll be all right. But yes, VBS is this week. It is finally here. So we ask first for your prayers for all the children and the workers and Jill and all the work that has gone into this week. And this week is about sharing the love of Jesus with all these children that come into St. Paul's next week. So be in prayer for everyone, but also it's not too late to sign up. So if you have any little ones that are age 4 through grade 5, please sign them up. You can sign them up in the Narthex, or you can sign them up in the morning. VBS is from 8:30 to 11:30. So please pass that word, and if you want to help, I'm sure Jill will find a place for you. So yes, VBS is going to be exciting. Well, let us pray now and just center our hearts for worship. Father God, we thank you that there is so much excitement here this morning. Lord, there's always something that you're doing and you're working through. And Lord, we are just privileged that you get to include each of us into your plans. So Lord, we just ask that that excitement continues throughout the service, that you'll just ignite within us a desire to serve you, to love others. Lord, help us to lay aside the things that keep us from true worship and help us to focus on you this very hour. Lord, renew us in this place that we call sanctuary. Lord, be with us now. In the name of Christ we pray. Amen.
Please stand and join me for this morning's call to worship. We look to the rulers of this earth for leadership, wisdom, and strength. We look to families and friends for love, compassion, and hope. When rulers betray and when families disappoint, God offers another look. God will guide us. God's Spirit will sustain us. Christ will welcome us home. Come, my sisters and brothers, we are all God's family now. Amen. Please remain standing as we join in the singing of Come, Thou Fount of Every Blessing, number 400 in our hymnal.
Thank you.
You may be seated. Please rise and join in as we affirm our faith. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. You may be seated.
And now we come to the time in our service where we're mindful of the things that are heavy on our hearts and the things that also bring us great joy. So we pause to give thanks in our hearts for all the good things we experience. And we also think of those that need our prayers. We lift up Jack Allen, Bob and Joan Payne, Charlotte and Paul Moore, Buddy Moore, Shirley Vining, Agnes Golson, our scouts as they left today with Jay Cunningham. We also pray for the family of K.E. Morgan, and I would like to include a family friend, the Shirley Lowry family. And we also remember that Clara Jane's family celebrated her life yesterday in a memorial service, so we keep them in our prayers. Let us center our hearts now. Thank you. God of all comfort, we come before you and we offer the things that are on our hearts and on our minds. We offer up the names of those we love that we just mentioned. And Lord, we offer up the things that we keep quietly within our own hearts. But we know that in the midst of sorrow, that you give us great joy. In the midst of fatigue, you renew us in ways that we can never imagine. Lord, when we are sad and lonely, you give us this unexplainable joy. And so, Lord, we come to you knowing that you are the one who can provide us with all the things that we need, that you receive our prayers, no matter how great, how small. And Lord, you make them your own. You're already working and moving and doing so much in each of our lives. And so, Lord, we trust in you. We trust in you and we surrender to you those we love, the situations we can't control, the things that hurt us. Lord, the ways in which we need you to strengthen us. All of these things we give to you because you are the God who sustains and carries us all the days through. And you are a good, good Father. So thank you for hearing and receiving our prayers and allowing us to pray these things in the name of your Son, Jesus, who has taught us to pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this daily bread and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Thank you.
this time, we bring to God our tithes and offerings, which support the ministries of the church. Please place your offerings and your communication card in the offering plate as you leave the sanctuary. Let us pray. Holy and forgiving God, it is easy for our lives to become solely focused on our families, yet you call us to a broader understanding of family. We prioritize our money around the needs of our families and our children, and yet you challenge us to a global view of family and to look at all children with the love we look on those who live under our roof. As we give to you, open our eyes to see the wider family, our ears to hear the cries of hurting, hungry children, our hearts to experience the generous love you pour down on us. We pray in the name of your Son, Jesus. Amen. As you are being seated, I invite the children to come forward to hear a message from Miss Jill.
Isn't that awesome? Now, it's funny that you point that out, because what is that supposed to be? A rock. That's exactly right. And we have that rock here because what are mountains made of? Rocks. That's exactly right. Well, I wanted to talk about rocks this morning because it reminds me of our scripture that we're going to hear. And so let's look at a picture of some rocks. We have this rock, and you're right, it is made out of tape. He came up here and said, is that made out of tape? Yes. So look at this picture of rocks where you can see the one in the back or the one up here. And those rocks are, how would you describe them? They're hard and sharp, and they kind of have jagged edges. And you can see some different colors, but they're kind of muted, right? But now, whenever the rocks, do you know what happens to rocks when they get polished? What happens to rocks when they get polished? Do you know? They get shiny, right? So let's look at this picture. Look. That's the same kind of rock once they've been polished. So now you can see how smooth and shiny. They're much more beautiful, aren't they? You can see the colors better. They are beautiful. Now, look at this picture of these children. Do they all look the same? No, those children do not look the same. They have different hair color. They have different skin color. Some have short hair. Some have short, long hair. Some are tall. Some are short. And I bet some of them have different talents too, right? They're different, right? Well, sometimes we look at people and we only see their rough edges, like those first rocks we looked at. Or maybe kind of like this rock. It's not perfect. And it's got dents. And sometimes that might be how we look at people. When we look at people, and we're looking at them in that way, we might only see their worst qualities. We might only see when they're crabby. Or we might only notice that they look different from us. Or maybe they dress different from us. Or maybe they have different skin color from us. But did you know that that's not at all the way God looks at us? When God looks at us, he sees the polished perfection version of you. And that's what he sees when he looks at me. Now, when you have a super good friend or when you're looking at your mom, that's kind of the vision you have. You know, we don't notice the bad stuff when we're looking at people that we love. And so that's how God wants us to look at children who we don't know, who might look different from us. God wants us to look at the polished version. and to look for the best in people. So how do we do that? We focus on the best things about people, right? We look for the beautiful things in that person. Now this week, this sanctuary will be full of kids. Y'all are coming, and hopefully lots more. I've got a lot of children registered for Bible school. And it's going to be so much fun, and I am so excited because guess what? I love children. They make me happy. They bring me joy. I will be laughing all week. It just fills my heart whenever I'm with children. So if you see something that you don't like in a person, all you have to do is ask God to take it away. When we pray and we ask God to help us see the best in people, He does it every single time. So as you go through this week, and as you're in school, or if you're on the ball field, I want you to remember that God wants us to look for the polished perfection version of people. He wants us to find the good in people. He wants us to see the best in one another. Okay? All right, let's pray together. Dear God, we thank you for loving us, and we pray that you'd help us to look at others by looking for the good in people. Help us to look for the best in the things, the best things in one another. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
Thank you, Jill, and children. Jill always does a super job, and we're looking forward to this week. It's definitely going to be unforgettable, I can already guess. Thank you for the children and grandchildren that are brought by parents and grandparents. Thank you for bringing them, not only for Sunday morning, but for vacation Bible school. Grateful also for Lori doing such an exceptional job, and for Monica helping us out today, and of course, Jay and Charles and others in the back. Thank you so much for all that you do to contribute to our meaningful experience today. We're looking at 1 Samuel chapter 16, verses 1, and then verses 6 through 12. Blessing the next generation. Blessing the next generation. It reads as follows. The Lord said to Samuel, "How long will you grieve over Saul? I have rejected him from being king over Israel. Fill your horn with oil and set out. I will send you to Jesse the Bethlehemite, for I have provided for myself a king among his sons." When they came, he looked on Eliab and thought, "Surely the Lord's anointed is now before the Lord." But the Lord said to Samuel, "Do not look on his appearance or on the height of his stature, because I have rejected him. For the Lord does not see as mortals see. They look on the outward appearance, but the Lord looks on the heart." Then Jesse called Abinadab and made him pass before Samuel. He said, "Neither has the Lord chosen this one." Then Jesse made Shema passed by, and he said, "Neither has the Lord chosen this one." Jesse made seven of his sons pass before Samuel, and Samuel said to Jesse, "Are all your sons here?" And he said, "There remains yet the youngest, but he is keeping the sheep." And Samuel said to Jesse, "Send and bring him, for we will not sit down until he comes here." He sent and brought him in. Now he was ruddy, and he had beautiful eyes, and was handsome. The Lord said, "Rise and anoint him, for this is the one." This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Amen. A couple of weeks ago, my lovely bride Millie and I were up in Arkansas on vacation, and my daughter Bethany and her husband Cody and their children, Jack and James, they were with us for a few days. And Jack is 5 years old, and he's constantly in motion, if you know what I mean. And then little James, he just turned two not too long ago, earlier this year, and he's trying to repeat everything he hears his older brother saying. So we keep telling Jack, "You better watch out what you're saying." And we as adults too, come to think of it. So we had a great time. But I noticed while we were there with them that Bethany and Cody, not only do they love their children, they have patience with those two boys. And something else is happening there. They bless their children. That means they favor both of them. They give both of them the gift of grace. During those 4 days, I noticed that was clearly evident. And this brings to mind for us today, how do we bless the next generation? Meaning our children and our grandchildren and our youth in our homes and in our neighborhoods and in our schools and in our church. So let's journey together through 1 Samuel chapter 16 to see if we may find some helpful hints. And first off, let go of your grief from the past. Right off the bat, we read in 1 Samuel chapter 16, verse 1, the Lord said to Samuel, how long will you grieve over Saul? I have rejected him from being king over Israel. Many of us are like Samuel. We carry emotional baggage from the past. We still grieve over some form of loss. It's only natural to grieve over the loss of someone or something of great value. See if one of these strikes a responsive chord with you. We may grieve over the loss of a car, the loss of a friendship, the loss of a house, the loss of a job, the loss of a loved one, the loss of money, or the loss of a pet. But the time comes for us to let go of our pain from the past. Eventually, to remain healthy, we must set our minds free from being dominated by painful memories. Sometimes this is easier said than done. Still, there's a reason for my bringing this up in the context of blessing the next generation. If we are locked into our grief from the past, we allow the painful past to steal the gift of joy from our hearts. Did you hear what I was trying to say? If we are locked into our grief from the past, we allow the painful past to steal the gift of joy from our hearts in the present moment. Then, if the primary attitude we display is grounded in grief, our younger ones will be tempted to follow suit. They may miss some of the joyful moments God has in store for them as they carry on our tradition of grief. To say it plainly, don't let your grief from the past steal tomorrow's joy from the next generation. Coupled with this idea to bless the next generation, move forward into the future with a sense of hope. As we read further in 1 Samuel chapter 16, verse 1, we find God's instructions to Samuel. Fill your horn with oil and set out. I will send you to Jesse the Bethlehemite, for I have provided for myself a king among his sons. If you lose your job, move forward with the hope that God will provide a new purpose for your life. If you lose a car due to an accident or repossession or theft, move forward, believing God will provide the necessary transportation. If you lose your house due to divorce, or you can't make the payments, or a tornado blows it away, move forward with the hope that God will provide a roof over your head. We have a choice. When life gets tough, and sometimes life is very tough, we have a choice to make about our attitudes. Without a doubt, our attitudes influence the young ones who are often watching us. We may influence the next generation with a pessimistic attitude, a negative attitude about the future, or we may influence the coming generation with a spirit of optimism, a positive outlook for tomorrow. The choice is ours. Further, to bless the next generation, quit judging books by their covers. We catch up with the story in 1 Samuel 16, beginning in verse 6. When they came, he looked on Eliab and thought, surely the Lord's anointed is now before the Lord. But the Lord said to Samuel, do not look upon his appearance or on the height of his stature, because I have rejected him. Some time back, I was serving another church as a pastor, and of course, on a Sunday morning, preached a sermon, and there was a family that were visiting that Sunday. A young man had brought his family, and the following week, he and I, our paths crossed, and he looked at me and he said, you know, preacher, you're a pretty good preacher, but you can't tell it by just looking at you. I was thinking, well, thanks for the left-handed compliment, big guy. Well, in connecting to the next generation, if we judge others by appearance, then judging by appearance may spill over into their hearts and minds. Then as the next generation judges others by appearance, a boomerang effect may take place. The next generation may in turn judge us based on how we look, and heaven help us if that happens. When it comes to the next generation, let's quit judging a book by its cover. Instead, to bless the next generation, look in their hearts for their true potential. We continue the story in 1 Samuel 16, verse 7. For the Lord does not see as mortals see. They look on the outward appearance, but the Lord looks on the heart. Look into the hearts of the children. What interests the child? What are the child's natural abilities? And let me be clear. It's not a question of the dreams you have for your child or your grandchild, but rather, what God-given dreams live in the heart of your child or your grandchild? What God-given dreams live in the heart of your child or your grandchild? My son Brian loved baseball when he was in high school. My daughter, when she was in high school, she loved cheerleading. Imagine the disruption if I had reversed the order and insisted on them going in the opposite direction of their God-given desires. Back then, I may have said, Brian, I want you to get your mind off of baseball. Instead, I want you to pay attention to cheerleading. I want you to be a cheerleader. You know, we once had a president who was a cheerleader in college at Yale University, I believe. So I want you to start thinking about cheerleading. So let me see you, son. Let me hear you. 2 bits, 4 bits, 6 bits a dollar, all for the Razorbacks. Lay down and waller. We have any Arkansas fans here today? You're watching my back, right? See, Lori's taking care of me. Good. Or I could have said to Bethany, I want you to forget about cheerleading. Instead, I dream of you one day playing for the USA Olympic softball team. So here's a bat. See if you can hit one of my pitches. Batter up. Both of them would have been crestfallen. Both of them would have been highly disappointed. Both of them would have resented their dad. Not a question about what my dreams are for my children or my grandchildren. What God-given dream lives in their hearts? On top of these possibilities to bless the next generation, trust them with important responsibilities. We see this principle in 1 Samuel chapter 16, verse 11. Samuel said to Jesse, are all your sons here? And he said, there remains yet the youngest, but he is keeping the sheep. He had a responsibility. We expect our children to be responsible. Give them responsibilities. Do you realize there are a number of young people who go off to college and they don't know how to load a dishwasher or wash dishes? There are high school graduates who don't know how to wash, dry, iron, and fold their own clothes. Someone else was doing it for them as they were growing up at home. Along these lines, I heard of an 18-year-old young man. His family had always provided for him whatever he needed. And he went off to college, and he had two roommates. And whenever he needed something clean to wear, he went into one of their rooms and borrowed a shirt or a pair of pants or jeans, socks, whatever he needed. Well, his roomies got fed up with him borrowing all their clothing without asking permission, and they got key locks for their doors to keep him out. And so eventually, his piles and piles of unwashed clothes, he gathered them up, and he moved out on out the door. If we want the next generation to be responsible, then let's bless them with responsibilities. Furthermore, to bless the next generation, include them in special occasions. We hear the prophet speaking in 1 Samuel chapter 16 once again in verse 11 now. And Samuel said to Jesse, send and bring him, for we will not sit down until he comes here. Now, 1 Samuel 16 refers to a special occasion. The preacher has come to dinner. But in this case, not all of the family has shown up. Be sure to include the next generation in the celebration of special occasions. Speaking of preachers coming to dinner, there's once a preacher who went to visit with the family for Sunday dinner, and he was sitting in the den with the youngest one, little Johnny, and they were just getting along well. Little Johnny was in elementary school, and the preacher struck up a conversation with little Johnny by asking him, what are we going to eat for Sunday dinner? And little Johnny said, goat. And the preacher answered, goat. And little Johnny answered, Mommy told Daddy this morning, remember, today after church, we're having the old goat for Sunday dinner. That used to be a lot funnier when I was a lot younger. This may have nothing to do with my sermon now that I think about it. But still, include your children and your grandchildren in the special occasions you celebrate in your family. To add to the above, choose a special task for each one of them. We see David being chosen to be king in 1 Samuel 16, verse 13. Then Samuel took the horn of oil and anointed him in the presence of his brothers, and the Spirit of the Lord came mightily upon David from that day forward. When I was in elementary school, every time we went out for recess, well, maybe not every time, but many times, we would choose up teams. And you know what would happen as we were getting ready to play kickball or softball or football or basketball or volleyball. Someone would get chosen last. However, when it comes to blessing the next generation, choose each child first. Pick each child for a special task. For instance, choose a young person to carve the turkey at Thanksgiving. Choose a member of the next generation to hand out the Christmas presents under the tree. Choose a child to place the star or the angel at the top of the Christmas tree. Choose each child for a special task. Speaking of choosing children for a special task, years ago many churches had what's known as a pump organ. In one particular church, this lady would play the pump organ where she had to use her feet to hit the pedals to make the air flow through the church pump organ. And then she could play the hymn, but she was too short. And so she had a young tyke, and he sat down cross-legged there by the little pedals, and he would pump the organ with his hands so she could play the keyboard. And one Sunday, she was recognized with all kinds of accolades for all the contributions she'd made to the church, especially being the church organist. But the little boy, nothing was said about him, not a word. The next Sunday, it was time for the prelude, and he was sitting there in place, and she was ready to play at the prelude, and she began to play, and nothing happened. And so she said, "Pump, pump the pedals." She started to play, nothing. She said again, "Pump the pedals." She tried, nothing. And she said, "Please, pump the pedals." And he said, "I was waiting for you to say, please." And he began to pump the pedals. He wanted some recognition. Here's the simple moral to the story. The next generation may be just beneath the surface, but they still play a vital role in the life of a family or a church family. To a certain extent, their presence pumps life into these wooden pews. To a certain extent, their presence pumps life into these wooden pews. This brings us back to blessing the next generation. That's one reason we have Vacation Bible School, to bless those who follow us. For it's our sincere hope in turn, one day they will pass the blessing on to generations to follow. If you'll bear with me for just a few seconds, I had a little illustration I wanted to share with you. I asked my daughter Bethany if I could share this with the congregation. She sings to her sons, Jack and James, before they retire for the evening and go to sleep. And so James is just barely two, and he's just starting to try to repeat what she says in song. She sent this to us.
Jesus loves me.
Bless the next generation with the hope that they will pass the blessing on to those who follow. And then maybe one day, the next generations will return the favor and bless you. Thanks be to God. Amen.
One of my favorite things about the Methodist Church is that the table is always open, and there's nothing more beautiful than when the children come And you get to offer them the blood, the body of Christ. And we come and we remember that now, the importance of an extended table. I invite you to turn to page 12 in your hymnal. Christ our Lord invites to his table all who love him, who earnestly repent of their sin and seek to live in peace with one another. Therefore, let us confess our sin before God and one another. Merciful God, we confess that we have not loved you with our whole heart. We have failed to be an obedient church. We have not done your will. We have broken your law. We have rebelled against your love. We have not loved our neighbors, and we have not heard the cry of the needy. Forgive us, we pray. Free us for joyful obedience. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And may you take a moment to confess your sins in private. Lord, thank you for receiving our prayers. Hear the good news. Christ died for us while we were yet sinners. That proves God's love towards us. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
Glory to God. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. And so with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join in their unending hymn. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy are you and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. By baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit.
On page 14, on the night in which he gave himself up for us, he took bread, gave thanks to you, broke the bread, gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." When the supper was over, he took the cup, gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me." And so, in remembrance of these your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit and your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. And now if you'll take your communion cup, if you'll peel back the top, please, you'll see a wafer there available for you. And also a second layer to be peeled back so that we can drink the communion juice. We'll make sure that everybody has communion cups. They're still being passed out. This is the body of Christ broken for you. This is the blood of Christ poured out for you. eat and drink in remembrance of him. Thanks be to God. Let us pray. Our Heavenly Father, we do pray that we will receive your blessings. We eat this bread, we drink this juice, hoping that we will receive more of your Spirit, your life, your blessings, your grace into our hearts. We pray that as we partake, that we will sense your presence here within us and among us, and that we'll go from here, passing on the blessing to not only the next generation, but to those who we come in contact with on a daily basis. These are our prayers we offer through Christ our Lord. Amen. Page 445 is our closing hymn, Happy the Home When God Is There, number 445. Let's stand together as we sing.
Thank you, RB, for that great reminder that there is a generation beyond us. And so may all the things that we know and love about Christ, about all of his creation, may it not end with us, but may we give and pay it forward for all those that come after us. May Christ continue. May the generations speak of all that he has for them. Amen.